In this video, I'd like to talk about series voltage regulators. In a previous video, I talked about shunt regulators, and we looked at a very simple circuit that contained a zener diode and a series resistor R sub S. There were two shortcomings with the shunt regulator that I hope to remedy here with the series regulator. In the shunt regulator, the series resistor might have to absorb a lot of current in order to drop the voltage between the input and the output sides. Similarly, the zener diode itself might have to carry a lot of current in order to maintain the output voltage. Let's see if we can remedy these two problems with the series regulator. At first glance, this might seem to be a rather complicated circuit. I have a transistor up there at the top. It seems to be turned on its side. What am I doing with that transistor? Well, let me explain it. This circuit is actually not too complicated. First, check out the position of the zener diode. The zener diode is what creates the reference voltage. In the shunt regulator, the zener diode breakdown voltage was essentially the voltage at the output side. In this case, the zener diode provides a reference voltage for the base of the transistor. In other words, the voltage at this node is fixed by the zener diode. If it's a silicon transistor, we can also say something about the base emitter junction. We know, for example, that silicon diodes typically have a 0.7 volt drop from the base to the emitter as long as it's in the forward active mode. That means that our load voltage is just going to be our zener diode breakdown voltage minus 0.7 volts. That's a very stable output voltage. The current, though, doesn't need to pass through the series resistor through the zener diode. In this configuration, the current passes through the transistor. That's one of the key differences of the series regulator versus the simple zener diode shunt regulator that we looked at before. Just to be clear, let's write down the equation that relates the load voltage to the zener diode breakdown voltage. If it's a silicon transistor, the base emitter voltage is going to be about 0.7 volts. In the shunt regulator, all of the current that goes to the load resistor has to pass through R sub S. However, in our series voltage regulator, only a small fraction of that current needs to flow through R sub S. That means that this regulator is more efficient. It doesn't burn up as much power when it's operating correctly. Something that we need to keep in mind when designing a series voltage regulator is that we are going to have some base current that has to flow up here through the transistor. Now, bipolar transistors typically have beta values of about 100, which means that the base current is usually going to be about a factor of 100 or so lower than the emitter current. Depending on how much current we expect our load to draw, we still need to ensure that we're going to have enough current passing into this junction to provide that necessary base current. We'll go through a detailed design in just a moment, but before we get to the design, I want to point out a couple of shortcomings with this circuit. The first shortcoming is that the base emitter voltage is not quite constant as the load current changes. I just pointed out that this voltage drop is usually about 0.7 volts if it's a silicon transistor. That's not really true. In fact, the emitter current depends on the base emitter junction in an exponential way. Let's plot the relationship between emitter current and the base emitter voltage at the junction for a transistor. If we assume a very simple model where we have a constant 0.7 volt drop across that junction, this is what the curve is going to look like. However, this is not the way the curve looks in reality. The real curve is going to look something more along these lines. The base emitter junction is going to change a little bit depending on the load. That's one of the shortcomings of this particular circuit. There are ways to fix that, but we need to use a feedback mechanism in order to fix it. I'll talk about that in a future video, but for now, I just wanted to point out the origin of the shortcoming. It's the fact that this relationship is exponential. It's not just a constant voltage drop. Although, assuming that it's a constant voltage drop still gives you a fairly good voltage regulation. The second shortcoming is that the zener diode may still need to handle a fair amount of current if the input voltage gets to be too high. Let's now design one of these series voltage regulators. Let's assume that our zener diode can dissipate a maximum of 2 watts. We're going to be calculating the resistance R sub S, and we'll be finding its power rating. In this voltage regulator, our input voltage is going to range between 12 volts and 18 volts, and our load voltage should be a constant 10 volts. If we assume that this is a silicon bipolar junction transistor, then let's go back to assuming that we have a 0.7 volt drop across that junction. This means that in order to get a 10 volt load voltage, we need to have a zener diode voltage at about 10.7 volts. Let's now calculate the worst case currents that are going to flow through this circuit. The worst case currents are going to happen when the input voltage is very high and the output voltage is 10 volts, which we hope it always is. Let's start with I sub S. We know the voltage here is going to be about 10.7 volts. In the worst case, we're going to have 18 volts on the other side of this resistor. We can just use Ohm's law in order to relate I sub S to R sub S. Let's now find the largest allowable I sub Z. The zener diode can only dissipate 2 watts of power. This means that the largest allowable current passing through it will be 187 milliamps. How about our load current, which I have labeled as I sub E here? It's an emitter current. The worst case load current is going to happen when the load resistor is at its minimum. We're told here that the minimum load resistance is just 10 ohms. With 10 volts at the output side and a 10 ohm resistor, we find that the maximum output current is going to be about 1 amp. If we assume a beta of 100 for this bipolar transistor, then we can approximate the worst case base current. So now the question I want to ask is, if we have 18 volts at the input side and we have 10 volts at the output side, what does the power rating of this resistor need to be? And what is the value of that resistance? We mainly need to make sure that the I sub S is large enough to supply the necessary base current when the load is at its worst. This means that the I sub S needs to be 10 milliamps at its minimum. Now, when is I sub S at its minimum? Up here, I've calculated the worst case scenario, but the worst case scenario represents the largest I sub S. I need to make sure that even in the minimum situation, this I sub S is still large enough to supply my base current. Since my zener diode can handle up to 187 milliamps, I'm now just going to make a design decision and say that I want 10 milliamps to flow through my zener diode just to make sure that it breaks down. Let's apply Ohm's law across R sub S. This gives me an R sub S of 65 ohms. This ensures that I can supply the necessary base current. At its max, 112 milliamps is flowing, which is less than the 187 milliamps that the zener diode can accommodate. In order to calculate the necessary power rating for the resistor, we're going to have to look at the worst case scenario, that is, when there's more current going through this resistor. Let's now find the maximum amount of power that would be dissipated in the resistor. We can use a resistor with a 1 watt power rating. Let's now summarize what we've done. We've chosen a zener diode that has a 10.7 volt nominal breakdown voltage. This ensures that I'm going to get 10 volts at my output no matter what. The only thing that we need to do with our circuit over here on the left is ensure that we can supply the necessary base current over the full range of input voltages. We found that the necessary base current is about 10 milliamps, and I added a little bit to it just to make sure that the zener diode would break down. We then found a value for our necessary I sub S, and from that we calculated the resistance value. We then looked at the worst case scenario in order to find the power rating. One of the limitations of this regulator is that the base emitter voltage is not actually going to be constant at 0.7 volts. In order to improve the situation, we need to use feedback. In the next video, we'll be looking at feedback voltage regulators.